this is John Cullen with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. I'm trying to hit this out literally in the next 15 minutes before the sun goes down, so I'm going to talk really fast. This will be one of my shorter episodes. I know some of you guys don't like the short ones, but some of you guys like the short ones. Anyways, we're here at Gratitude Gardens in Loxahatchee, Florida. They do not accept visitors, so don't try to come here, but you can see them at the farmer's market, the Palm Beach Gardens farmer's market that I was at, that maybe you saw me there at. They go there as well as, I think, three other markets here in town. You got to check with them to see what they are, because I don't really know. But basically, this is a diversified farm here. As you guys can see behind me, they got like all these amazing eggplants, and they got peppers, and they got leafy greens, and they got all kinds of different crazy mango trees that they go out of their way to grow in this more humid climate than if they were in like a more drier Palm, West Palm Beach area. So they have to like spray boron at the right time. They have to really have a good mineral program to give the plants the nutrients they need so that they can fruit optimally. Of course, they also have behind me there the whole border of the whole farm. They have a fence on the outside, but the whole border of the whole place, the farm, is all bananas. So they have different kinds of bananas that hopefully I get to try today. But you know, basically this farm is known for their ginger and their turmeric that they can ship to you, and they have some very special varieties of ginger and turmeric. But aside from the ginger and turmeric, which are very highly medicinal plants, they are also growing mushrooms. So mushrooms also very medicinal. I would encourage you guys to eat mushrooms. Mushrooms contain angiogenesis inhibitors, so that means it's preventing the growth of new blood cells, which can be important, say if you have cancer, for example. And actually that's the reason why this farm started, right? The owner of the farm was actually living in Deerfield, beach around here somewhere near Fort Lauderdale, and he was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer, right? And maybe he'll tell you guys this later because I'm interviewing him. I will have time for that. Stage 4 cancer, and the doctors said, you have 1 year to live if you do exactly what we say, which they want to go through the standard medical system. And he's like, I don't want to live one more year. I'm going to find alternatives. So then he looked into different alternative therapies. He went to Hippocrates Health Institute, actually just down the way here in West Palm Beach. He did infrared sauna. He did all these different things. He took in his 3-bedroom house. He started growing sprouts in one of the bedrooms. Actually, I'll post a link down below to my buddy Dave, who basically is doing the same thing to this date, growing the sprouts. Very nutritious. In addition, the guy basically on his whole outside of his house, he basically grew a garden, raised beds, and that's when he found me. This was probably about 10 years ago. He was probably growing, and then he found me. And nowadays, he like wanted a project to do. He recovered from his cancer. And then he's like, you know what? I'm just taking care of myself. How can I have a purpose in life besides just taking care of myself and recovering and healing? So basically he started the Gratitude Gardens, and probably much like me, I'm here today only because I can only say through higher powers, I was healed through my chronic health condition that the doctors told me I might not make it out of the hospital alive. I'm glad to be here today. My channel isn't called Gratitude Growing Your Greens, but I'm actually quite grateful that I was given a second chance at life, and I was going to do something productive in my life to help other people, because it's more than just about making profit, making money in our lives. We need to help thy fellow man. You know, this is said in many different religions or sayings around the world, right? And that's what we really got. We just got each other. And so that's why he really started this farm, to give himself a project, also to, number one, have the highest quality food for him and his family, but also, you know, give him something to do with his time that he was blessed to have. It's now been, I think, 10 years after he got diagnosed with cancer, and he's still here 10 years later. He did not follow what the doctors said that would give him 1 year. He now has 10 years by basically sticking to a plant-based, nutrient-dense diet, you know. And that's why he grows some of the things he does. You know, he grows edible leafy greens, he grows the microgreens, he grows the turmeric and the ginger and special kinds of ginger and turmeric that you will not find other places easily. And also many different mushrooms and many different varieties of mushrooms. So he sells those at local markets. And actually for you guys out there in YouTube land, he will ship you guys some, but not all of these crazy varieties of ginger, as well as some of the mushroom tonics and tinctures or whatever they're gonna be make to really give you that, guys, the power of these beneficial superfoods. And these are foods that he has on a regular basis to basically prevent his cancer from coming back. Maybe I don't want to say like that. I want to say so that he could be healthy, so that he doesn't have get any kind of diseases in the future, right? And you know, many Americans, in my opinion, are eating too much fast food, too much junk food, too much processed food, animal foods in excess, and you know, that is a result. And then unfortunately they go through the cancer therapy and do what the doctor said, and you know, in my opinion, they don't live as long as they should. You know, so I'm glad he's here to do this to people in the West Palm Beach County that could buy his products locally, because most of them are sold locally through the different markets. He also employs a staff of people that he now employs to basically help him take care of this, because he is working his butt off. I didn't see much of a butt on him, actually, because he's working it off. He works like 10-hour days, and he doesn't get enough sleep, so I was like really pounding into him, like, dude, you need to get enough sleep. Like, yeah, working is good, but if you're trying to heal and not have a reoccurrence or whatever, you need to get your sleep. So, hey, if you're watching this right now, man, get some sleep, dude. So anyways, I don't have a lot of time left, so I really want to cover some of the important points of the cool things he's doing here before it really gets dark, and what makes this, sets this farm apart from other farms in the area that I visited, and even sets it apart from other farms around the country that I visited, all right? So the first thing is, right here in this room, they have a super huge reverse osmosis system, so they don't feed the water or the reverse osmosis water to all the whole property, but all the outlying areas, some of the plants get the RO water, including the microgreens, including the mushrooms, including, you know, there's their personal buildings here. But in addition, they also store their fertilizers in here as well, and some farming equipment, so let's share that with you. So number one, you know, because he's into his health like I am, right, he uses the rock dust. Now, he used to use the azomite, which I do promote and recommend as a wide spectrum kind of trace mineral for your soil. He's now using an even better one than the azomite. Azomite's really high in silica, but it doesn't have a good spectrum of other minerals. He's using the agro wind minerals, volcanic rock dust, and this is for micro and macro nutrients. This is definitely a good one. I would recommend. The only problem with this is that it's a little bit pricey. If you want to get it, you can check them out at fertilizeronline.com. He's also using one of my favorite things. He's using worm castings. I don't know this brand myself, so I gotta check into it a little bit more, but I did see it. It looks like decent stuff, but I gotta vet it myself. So, but number one, worm castings and the rock dust, two super critical ingredients to add. They also make a compost tea with a compost tea brewer behind me, and they have like an organic slow release fertilizer with the calcium. Calcium is very important for the uptake of other nutrients as well. And you know, here's their basically Jang cedar, and they also, you know, you're not going to find a rotor tiller here because they don't till the soil. This is a more of a no-till method. They have a little mixer here that basically mixes the first couple inches of the soil here. I don't want to stay the whole time in the barn, but I just want to show you guys, actually, these are some of the things they do to add fertility to the soil. But that's not even the majority of the fertility, right? When they flip a bed, they add in the worm castings and the rock dust. But, you know, here's some beds they just started, and let me show you guys the process. So basically what they do is they make their own compost here on site that I don't know that I'll have time, but I saw the process. They basically take their sprint mushroom material, which is wood chips, and they mix in some straw with it. They compost that down to make the compost, which is underneath here, because literally in West Palm Beach, it's the beach, and most of Florida is actually sand, so they can't grow in the soil. So this is like the soil level here, and as you guys can see, this is raised up, mounded up, so they're growing in really rich compost that then they planted their eggplants in, and then they basically top this off with the spent mushrooms. Because they grow mushrooms and plants, they're able to use the spent mushrooms, you know, material that the mushrooms are grown in as actually mulch, which I think is really cool, and I'll show you why in just a little bit. So aside from growing the turmeric and ginger and mushrooms, which are highly medicinal, also medicinal to me, and as my channel states, it's called Growing Your Greens, and it's called Growing Your Greens for a reason, because I want you guys to grow and eat your greens. Greens are I call them medicinal foods. My goal is to eat 2 pounds of leafy greens a day, so actually after tonight, I'll be eating some of these greens tonight for dinner. But he has all different kinds of greens growing, you know, different kinds of radish or daikon turnip greens, mustard greens, kale greens, collard greens, sorrel greens. And check this out, this is the bed here that they're growing the mustard greens in, and this is a spent material, and I want to take you guys down here and show you guys this. So check this out, this is their mustard greens growing, and I encourage you guys always to eat purple foods whenever you guys can. I don't know if they're growing the standard green variety, but they got the purple variety. Purple foods are always more nutritious than the green variety due to the anthocyanins in there. And then right below, they got all their spent mushrooms material down in here. And check this out. They got mushrooms growing in there. John, that looks gross, man. There's a mushroom underneath the plant. Well, no, this is one of the best things you guys could do. Now, they don't harvest these guys because the ones they harvest actually are grown in their climate-controlled, special, sterile mushroom rooms. But this is cool nonetheless that their spent material are still going to be able to grow the mushrooms. I think these are some maybe oyster mushrooms or something like that. So they grow in these basically raised beds made out of concrete blocks. They also have other methods of growing, like in the soil, in the field, but more importantly here in the sandy, Florida, the best way to grow is something like this, in these fabric pots. So basically they have fabric pots, so they grow many different ways. And because they grow many different ways, that allows them to grow many different kinds of different foods. So once again, you know, this is the dinosaur kale, or lacinato kale, very nutritious plant. And this is the ones that's actually resistant to the heat, more so than other varieties that I found. I'm able to grow this through the summertime in the desert. So they have many different ways. And of course, they're also mulching. Here they're mulching with some of the straw here, and a mulch also very important in this hot climate. I want to go down here further to the end and actually show you guys actually some of the turmeric growing. All right, so over here, this doesn't look like anything's growing. Now that's because now it's the winter season for West Palm Beach, despite the weather being like 70 degrees here. But this is the turmeric growing, and it dies back when it gets too cold, and that's the time that it tells you that it's time to pull this stuff up. And if I dig this out somewhere, all right, so check this out. I mean, this is a big clod of like root mass and turmeric that they're probably gonna leave in for seed because it's really small, but they still got the turmeric growing, and now is the time they're gonna be harvesting, so they haven't harvested this bed out yet. They also have ginger growing as well as the galangal ginger. Check this out, man, the galangal ginger is still growing really well. They tried to grow it under a tunnel, but it grew a lot better outdoors, and this stuff still looks nice and healthy. I think before it gets too dark, I actually wanna show you guys actually some of the ginger and turmeric that they harvested for me, and I'm gonna try it for you guys on camera. All right, so now I'm gonna show you guys actually some ginger and turmeric that was just harvested. This is the galangal ginger. Look at the color on that, man. And then here's some of the ginger that they just harvested here. Look at that, that's sprouting up. This is actually when you wanna break this off and then plant the new tips coming up, divide it out. I think this one is actually known as the Hawaiian red turmeric. So this one, to me, I could eat like carrots. And it's totally amazing. I love the flavor on this. It's really mild, so if you don't like hardcore tasting stuff, you're gonna get some of the health benefits from the turmeric by eating the Hawaiian kind. I love Hawaii. Let's see, next here, we got, I think, the standard Indian kind turmeric. This is kind of more maybe like a little bit orange, not quite as deep, so I wanna go ahead and put these in. Once again, I wanna encourage you guys to eat your foods of color, so this is, to me, like a better, but this one might taste a little bit stronger than this guy. I'll be trying these guys maybe in a little bit. I want to introduce them all. Let's see. This is maybe like a yellow kind turmeric. This is not ginger. Might look like ginger to you, but this is the yellow turmeric, actually. Now we get into some of the crazy turmeric, right? So, the turmerics that you saw may have like curcumin percentages of like 4 to 5%. This is like the medicinal one that's like, I don't know, in the teens. I think 16 or 18%. Like super hardcore, like you're never gonna find this stuff, but that's the stuff they grow here because literally, you know, Hippocrates said, let food be thy medicine and medicine be thy food, and this right here is medicine. Although this to many people is medicine, this is food, right? And we're gonna try these on camera for you guys. And then, oh my God, this one is super special. It doesn't grow as fast and it looks long and lanky, whereas I mean the Hawaiian one is really made for production. Look at that, lots of more weight on there. Even the Indian one, look at these ones, man, right here. This is a lot of weight. These don't have a lot in here, not a lot of fingers on there. This is, once again, another medicinal one, and this was broken earlier, and this is actually the, they might call this the blue or the purple or the black. Once again, more medicinal, and I heard it tastes like butt. Well, we'll let you figure out what that tastes like. And actually, I think I'll taste it, because I think that's all the different kinds. They have just different pieces in here and whatnot. But I'm gonna sample these guys out for you guys to let you know. I'm not gonna try the gingers today because it could taste pretty strong, but they really focus on the turmeric here because that really grows well in this climate. So this is the Hawaiian, and I was just in Kauai. If you guys checked out my videos at the Kauai Pharmacy, I tried some of this stuff, and I'm like, man, I could eat this stuff instead of carrots. And if something's not that strong to you, then to me, it doesn't have that much medicinal value. Although still, you know, turmeric is way more valuable to me than carrots. So I'd rather eat turmeric than carrots. So we're just gonna pop off a little nub here for you guys. Right there, and we're gonna go ahead and eat it. So it has a crunch of a nice baby tender carrot. And to me, I mean, to you guys, you might taste, oh man, tastes like turmeric. To me, this tastes so mild because the turmeric I get, usually a lot stronger. But to me, I would just shred this up and put on salads all day long, every day of the year. Actually, this is the kind of turmeric sometimes I'm able to juice. And here's the thing, right? As good as turmeric is, it's only as good as much as you eat it, right? I want you guys to eat it on a regular and consistent and everyday basis, you know. If you're from Indian descent, like from India, you guys are eating turmeric in your curry sauces and curry seasonings and all this stuff all the time. Most Americans rarely ever eat the turmeric. So what does that mean to you? Maybe you could have turmeric shots. I eat turmeric ginger shots every day. If you come to the farmer's market here, you could buy their turmeric ginger shots, which I had, which is actually quite good. If you're not here, then buy a juicer and juice them up yourself. If not, shred them up on salads. Add them to different meals, you know. Let's see, so that's the Hawaiian. I think that tastes pretty mild to me. Next, I think another mild one might be that kind of yellow or the white one. And we're gonna pop off a little nub right here. This guy right here, little finger. Wow, that has a different flavor, man. Once again, this is not as colorful, does not probably have as much beta carotene in there. To me also, this is just eat out of the hand quality, man. Like, I would just spread this up and eat it like I would like white carrots or something. But nonetheless, turmeric way more beneficial than eating the carrots. I'm getting that little tickle in my throat right now. Despite it tasting mild, still hitting my throat a little bit. Wow, for the flavor wise, actually I kind of like the yellow, but the yellow one's messing my throat up, which the Hawaiian one didn't do, all right? Next, we're kind of getting more hardcore. The Indian one, this is the kind of one that I probably usually get, but I'm not exactly sure. Because when you go to buy turmeric in the store, generally, the only difference is turmeric, or maybe white turmeric. They don't really tell you the variety, if it's Hawaiian, or for the Indian, or the different cultivar. Much like if you go to the store and buy avocados, usually just says avocados. If you buy, you know, garlic, just says garlic. So many varieties of garlic as well as avocados. All right, so we're just gonna break off a little nub here. Maybe this guy. Eat it. All right. This has more of that classic turmeric taste that I'm used to. Stronger flavors. I wouldn't necessarily be cranking this off and shredding it on salads. It's a lot stronger, affecting my throat a little bit more. But on one hand, it's actually probably also more medicinal. All right, so this is the BKK turmeric. This is the more medicinal version. This is 8 to 12% curcumin in there. A lot stronger, so we're gonna break off a little nub of this and see how this does when I eat it. And I think the other varieties were like maybe 4 to 5. I like the flavor of this. It's nice and the texture is really soft because these are like not as big. Maybe more baby, I don't know. But this I find agreeable, but I'm getting, once I chew it all up, I'm really getting a strong flavor punch in my mouth. Like, it's not like burning my mouth like cayenne would, but it's kind of like have a strong flavor like ginger would. I mean, I'm still good with it, so I could probably, I don't know if I could eat this whole thing straight, then I might be in some problems, but now, oh man, I'm feeling it really now in my throat. It's like, it's kind of getting scratchy and hot at the same time. All right, I've saved the best and most medicinal one for last. This is known as the blue, purple, black, whatever you want to call it, turmeric. And this one is only used for medicinal purposes. It's supposed to be tasted really bad. You wouldn't want to shred this up on a salad by any means. It'd probably ruin your whole salad. I tasted this once, like in a video, but really not that much. This is the largest kind of like a mass I've ever held. So we're just gonna break off this little tip here. And once again, it's a little bit, blue on the inside. We're gonna try a little piece here. Oh my God, that's insane. So right now, wow. I mean, there's some herbs that I've tasted, some herbs that taste like ass, like literally tastes like me. I don't know how else to describe it. I've never tasted ass personally. I'm not an ass muncher. but this stuff tasted really strong. Like, wow. Like, oh, I know. If you had like cough syrup, right? If you had cough syrup straight, and then I don't know if they flavor cough syrup or whatever, that's what this tastes like. It tastes super strong. Oh my God, like, yeah, I mean, I'm tasting it. Like, if I juice this straight and drank it, I might be in some problems. So, as cool as the purple turmeric is, we probably should only use it in like small limited amounts. You know, it's not like maybe for regular everyday eating, although I would like to include more of this in my diet and have access to this. By the looks of it, you know, once again, it doesn't look like it grows quite as quickly, so you're not gonna find it, and if you do, it's gonna be quite very expensive, so they'll probably be processing this into value-added products if you guys want to get some of this. I think the one that I'd recommend for flavor personally, but not nutrition, I really like the yellow one here, the white turmeric. And then obviously for nutrition and flavor, then I'd go with the Hawaiian red. And then I guess lastly, I'd go with that standard Indian. And unfortunately, this is the one that you're probably gonna find in most cases, in my opinion, and I don't know this for sure, at, you know, the local supermarket near you, because this is the one that tastes most like the one that I often get when I'm shopping for organic turmeric. Now, if you guys wanna grow this stuff, you guys could do that, but please know this, conventional turmeric may be sprayed with growth inhibitors, so they may never sprout or root out for you, so that they don't lose their profit. So if you guys wanna grow your own, get some good organic turmeric, and I would encourage you guys to actually buy turmeric from the farm here, so you could grow out these very varieties that I tried in this episode. They simply taste amazing, and then you know that they're not gonna be sprayed with any kind of growth inhibitors, these are grown organically using the best growing practices that I share some of what they do with you guys. So that's it for the turmeric. I'm not gonna try the ginger today. I gotta save my mouth here. But what I wanna do before it gets dark, because the sun's going down, I wanna show you guys actually the mushrooms are growing that are completely amazing and also quite medicinal. I've been to other mushrooms farms before, but they're doing a little bit differently here than other places. All right, so literally we are in the middle of Loxahatchee here in South Florida. And it's basically just 5 acres of the property. They have it planted out in the bananas and the fruit trees, as well as the vegetables in the ground, the vegetables in the raised beds, as well as the vegetables in the pots, but they're also growing in other ways. So basically, if you're in the middle of Loxahatchee, you can easily drop down shipping containers and maybe even paint them nicely with clouds on there, and not get in trouble with your HOA or other entities that maybe don't want shipping containers in some areas. So I'm glad they're able to do this. So they'll basically buy a shipping container, and some of these were as low as about $1,100 and then plus shipping to get them here, literally, for the shipping container. And then now they're able to grow in a climate-controlled area, because you will not be growing microgreens outdoors. I don't know how many emails I get from people, John, could I grow microgreens in a greenhouse? I do not recommend growing microgreens in a greenhouse, because you cannot control the temperature. You will not want to grow microgreens or even mushrooms in a greenhouse, because you cannot properly regulate the temperatures. So they go to the microgreens as well as the mushrooms. And I want to show you guys the microgreens first, because that was actually an essential part, and the sprouts, an essential part of the owner's healing, cancer healing journey, because he's been growing these guys for the last 10 years. So while this farm is growing the microgreens, right, he does not ship these microgreens. There's other companies that do that. He does source the best seeds, because I did talk to him about his seed source, and he grows the microgreens for local markets so that he can provide literally that life-changing healing food. So this is how he grows the microgreens. It's not super rocket science. You know, he's got different microgreens here, such as the sunflower greens that he's growing. I'm sure he also has the pea greens here somewhere. I don't know exactly where they are, but I'm not really gonna get into the microgreens that he's growing, but know this, right? Microgreens and baby plants, you know, such as he's growing over here. Oh, these are maybe like some radish or broccoli microgreens that they got under the light deprivation right now. And then here's here's some nice finished sunflower microgreens or sunflower sprouts. We're gonna go ahead and try one of these guys. I love these guys. I gotta get that turmeric flavor out of my mouth. Mmm. Man, nice and refreshing. Actually, I think I wanna eat this for dinner tonight. Of course, also in here, he uses this for germination. So he's germinating like organic seeds to grow. Like this is gonna be like, I think some Swiss chard here and maybe some tomatoes that he's gonna be planting out in just a little while. But I want to really inspire you guys to grow and eat microgreens, right? He's doing it inside a shipping container here in South Florida, because this is independent of the weather, right? He actually has an air conditioner on in here to control the temperature, to have this an enjoyable temperature for us. I mean, in the summertime, it's gonna be high humidity and really hot. Right now, some of the nights are getting too cold, and the microgreens would not like the 37 degrees that it had on the day that I actually flew in, or the wheatgrass. So, these guys like the temperature that we like to live in, so if it's comfortable in your home, then you can comfortably grow microgreens. I have many videos on microgreens. I'm not going to get into the growing process here, but know this, that I really want all you guys to be growing microgreens if you're not already and you have a lot of time and stay at home a lot. Number one food, because it's the most nutritious, 4 to 40 times more nutritious than the whole full-size vegetables outside. And you could literally, the microgreens, unlike some of the plants out there that could take a month or 2 months to grow, these guys literally could be ready in about 10 to 14 days, maybe even as short as 7 days. Sprouts can be done in as short as 1 day. I sprout buckwheat just brought buckwheat in one day in my climate doing my special techniques that I don't have a video on yet, but I need to do that. But yeah, other little sprouts can be done in less than a week, and you could literally be growing your own food and having high quality food at that you could harvest fresh. So the AC came on because I got the door open, so I gotta get out of here. All right, it's probably too dark to see me maybe at this point, but what we're gonna do is we're gonna take you into one of those, another shipping container and show you guys the mushroom grow that they got going. So probably, I mean, the most important thing for the mushroom grow is three things. Number one, you gotta control the temperature, you gotta control the humidity, and you gotta control the CO2. So they have systems to, you know, do the venting, the fanning, and, you know, filter the air. They have a whole solid, you know, air conditioning system in here to keep the proper temperature. They have CO2 meters as well as CO2 that they pump in to make sure that's right. And we're gonna go in here and show you guys the four varieties of mushrooms that they currently have in production in this house. So in this house, at this time, they have four different varieties of mushrooms. I think they have some kind of oysters and some kind of, here's some pink oysters, and they have some pino or something, like four different kinds. And you can see, like, check this out, man, it's like, I'm being fogged in, right? I think the humidity in here is actually quite high. I think it's like 95% humidity. So, I mean, although it's humid in Florida, this would not be growing outside. So I think, to me, you know, I haven't visited a mushroom farm in Florida before. And I was like, how could you do that? Like, I really want to see somebody do this in a desert climate. Like, that'd be really cool. But yeah, you can see these mushrooms coming out. And right now, these are not sporing out. They do not let them spore out, so that you don't have to wear the masks in here like other farms I've been to. These are just before the spore stage, because if it was in the spore stage, I'd have to wear a respirator, or actually all the spores of the mushroom that they release can be quite toxic. And look at these guys look beautiful. They've recently switched their substrates. They were growing in straw, and now they're starting to grow in the wood chips, which allows them greater flexibility to grow wider varieties. But at the same time, it also has been a little bit more challenging for them. They have a full sterilization room and a lab and everything to do all the inoculation. I don't have time to show you guys that, but I just wanted to show you guys some of the amazing mushrooms that they're currently growing in here. And on a side note, I really want and to encourage you guys to eat mushrooms on a regular and everyday basis. One of the things I generally eat at night when I'm not traveling at home is I add mushrooms to everything, like to every basically sauce in the form of dried mushrooms. Sometimes I just snack on dried mushrooms and eat them and dip them in guacamole, for example. And you know, there's a simply amazing food, and I think more people need to eat more mushrooms, and not just the standard buttons, right? The standard buttons, hey, that's great if you're eating button mushrooms, or the portobellos, or the baby bellas, but we need to have some more of these kind of medicinal mushrooms that are actually quite beneficial, and as many of them as you possibly can. You know, they also grow other kind of mushrooms that are not in production now. You know, they'll sell these at markets, so they don't ship them except for making some kind of tinctures and extracts that they'll sell you guys through the mail that I'll show you guys in a minute. And they grow up, they'll grow out things like reishi and whatnot, you know, when they're growing out for their specific tincture that they're going to make in-house and use in-house that they actually don't release and sell to the public. All right, now we're gonna go into another container that's even growing more mushrooms, and these are segregated from the other ones because the other ones wouldn't like these ones and these ones wouldn't like the other ones. Well, maybe not exactly. What you're gonna see now is actually we're going into the house once again that they got the fans and the air conditioning, but inside here they have a very special mushroom, right? And this is another mushroom that actually I need to personally eat more of that I'm not eating as much of. It comes in one of my mushroom powders that I have, but these are known as the lion's mane. These look like, I mean, that's because they look like a mane of a lion. Look at that. I'm not going to touch these guys, but it kind of looks like a big kind of cauliflower looking thing, right? And as I come back, you guys can see some of this amazing lion's mane that they grow and sell. And yeah, culinary is just my easiest for culinary purposes, but there's a lot of research on the lion's mane, and you know, that it's good for like your brain and your mental mood and all these kind of things, right? So I want you guys to look into that more. And the special thing about this is that these will not grow in the other room. The other room in here, check out, they got these mushrooms in here too. But the other room is far too humid, so the humidity in here is about 82% humidity, as well as the CO2. They gotta have the proper CO2, so the CO2 and the humidity and the temperature in here, this is a little bit warmer, not as cold as the other room. You know, they control this and pump in the proper, they have the right controllers to control the humidity and the temperature, as well as the CO2, so that they could be successful growing this. I haven't seen too many other mushroom farms growing this. You know, because they want to grow more of a wider spectrum, and here once again they're focusing on growing highly medicinal foods and making them available for people. Once again, these guys, I think they sell them locally, but also they'll turn those into different extracts that is a true dual extract that actually I'm going to take you guys and share with you guys some of the products that you can actually buy online and get shipped to you guys if you guys want to support this farm so they continue their work and their mission to provide high quality, basically food that is medicine. All right, so now here is the final container I'll be going into tonight. Actually, this is a preparation container and a refrigerator container for half of it. And this is where they basically prep for farmers market and have the product stored, bring it out for farmers market, prepare for farmers market, but also ship to you guys that you guys aren't lucky enough to live in the Palm Beach County area to come to one of the local four farmers markets. So let me go ahead and show you guys actually some of the products that they could ship you guys. All right, so don't mind the mess. It's basically just shipping where they do all the shipping and they got all the boxes. But inside here are some of the products you guys could order. The ones you could order are the turmeric here. So like the turmeric I tried, it's certified USDA organic on all the produce that they produce. They got the different kinds of turmeric there that you could buy. They also got the young ginger that you could buy here. They also have actually different kinds of tinctures from the mushroom tinctures as well as some of the turmeric tinctures. They also have the golden milk now that they will be selling that made from their turmeric on site. And then the other thing you could buy are these guys. So these guys are basically pre-inoculated blocks all ready to go so you can grow your own medicinal mushrooms. And this is actually the lion's mane. So this block here, they'll ship it to you. It's actually cold right now. And if you don't want them to fruit out, then you will actually just put it in the fridge. And then when it fruits out, it'll pretty much look like this. And you'll probably get about 2 pounds of the lion's mane. So now I want to show you guys actually more about the products that you could ship and that they offer here. And I'm going to try some more of them on camera. All right, so now I want to show you guys actually some of the products they're producing here on site. Some of them will be more valuable or not according to where you live, where you are, and what you exactly are looking for. So for gardeners, number one is I would encourage you guys to reach out and get some of their special turmeric varieties that you can actually order and eat them fresh, juice them up, whatever you want to do with them for medicinal purposes. Or you can even plant them in your garden so you could grow these exact varieties. That being said, if you're in a tropical climate like South Florida, maybe like with maybe South Texas have a long season, maybe like San Diego, then it would be really advisable to grow the turmeric. If you live in a colder climate, like up, in New York and you have a greenhouse, then you could probably get away with growing, some turmeric or ginger up there. I think as far south as Orlando, I've seen people successfully grow the turmeric and the ginger up in Orlando. But otherwise, you might want to just sprout it indoors and grow it out indoors and then bring it, transplant it outside and get as long of a growing season as you possibly can and cross your fingers that it gets big enough because it does need a nice long growing season. Some of them actually grow a little bit quicker. I think this guy grows a little bit quicker as well as this guy. It's more vigorous and grows a little bit faster. And so here's the thing, although I'm showing you guys the turmeric now, it's harvest season right now. Luckily, harvest season, depending on the variety, can be from like November all the way through like March, and I don't know when this video is going to air, so they may or not have this available, and I don't know when you guys are going to be watching this because this will be online after I publish it, but you may be watching it in when they don't have this available on their website. So if it's available, they're going to have it on their website, and you can order it, and they'll harvest it fresh to order. So the cool thing about this farm is unlike other farms that may harvest it all in one day and then store it, and then ship it to you as you need it, they basically leave it in the ground and only dig it up as needed, as required, as they're gonna use it. So this way it stays the freshest and the healthiest as possible. So once again, you guys could order the different turmerics here. I think this is the white turmeric. They call this the white one, which I like for eating purposes the most. And then of course they have that Hawaiian kind, the red one. And then actually they have the standard, I think this is the Indian kind right here. And then they had, I think this is the Thai BKK turmeric. This is the most medicinal turmeric. It also costs more money, but if you guys are looking for medicinal value and don't mind the flavor, this is the one you're gonna wanna get. But of course, just for standard eating on a regular basis, I think the curcumin content in here is 2 to 3 times more than the curcumin content of these other varieties. So once again, they'll ship these to you, and they ship them in a good way, man. They'll harvest them up, and they'll basically put them in like insulated bag like this, and then even put a couple ice blocks in there for you guys to keep it cold as it is shipped to you guys through priority mail. which in most parts of the United States can get there in as short as 2 days. Let's see, the other products they'll ship to you guys, once again, you could order these blocks, right? Get this block, you're gonna take some kind of Tupperware like this, and you're gonna basically put this in here, you're gonna cut a couple X's in this packaging, like this is three X's here, so you got an X, 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 and you can see out of the X's, that's where the lines mean grow. So this, they sell these actually present time for $25, the price may change, but basically you're gonna get to harvest 2 pounds of the mushrooms from here. You're gonna basically cut a couple X's, put it in the box, and then you're basically just gonna mist it with a sprayer, two to three times a day, and they're gonna grow your mushrooms for you. And they have videos online on how to do this, so that's totally amazing. Grow your own mushrooms. I mean, if you don't buy this from them, that's all right, because they will grow them out themselves and then sell you mushrooms, in which case they're gonna make twice as much money, because I think they sell the mushrooms for $25 a pound, whereas you can get like 2 flushes out of this, and that's about 2 pounds. That would cost you $50 if you have to buy the mushrooms, or you could have the joy of trying to grow them yourself and seeing how it works. In addition, they will also sell you guys the ginger here. They got, once again, that red galangal ginger, a little bit different. I would encourage you guys, like, even if you live in Northern California, maybe have an unprotected greenhouse that's not heated, this guy has grown really well for me, and this is beautiful ginger. And of course, they just got the standard ginger, and they'll actually ship it to you just like this, even sprouting and ready to grow. I didn't get to try it earlier, but we're gonna go ahead and try some of their young ginger that may light me up. So we're just gonna go ahead and take a little piece off here. This is ginger, not the turmeric. We're gonna eat. Mmm. Wow. So that's definitely stronger. Woo! I'm feeling that in my mouth, man. It's like that strong. I wouldn't say it's like cayenne, but it's kind of burning. Oh. Oh, well. I gotta sit and eat this for a little bit. Let the hotness, like, chill out a little while. That ginger lit me up. Fortunately enough, the ginger, unlike the cayenne, like, hotness hangs around for a while. This is still hanging around my mouth, but it dissipates relatively easily. But I need to dilute it with something. So, unfortunately, they do not ship these. You guys cannot get these, guys. And these are basically their turmeric ginger lemon with a little bit of distilled water, and this one actually has the honey in there. They use a local honey. You can get ones without honey. They do not ship these, but if you guys are lucky enough to live here in Palm Beach County, you could go to one of 4 farmers markets that you'll learn about at the end of this video and get these. So we're gonna go ahead and sample this out. I have ginger turmeric shots, and normally the shots that I make have a lot more ginger and less turmeric, because I could get organic ginger for like 4 times less money than the turmeric. But here at the farm, they grow a lot more turmeric than ginger. So this is actually mostly turmeric with less ginger. And you wanna shake it up until you don't see any particulate at the bottom. They make this in a cold press, which is probably the best way to juice it. I'd probably use a vertical juicer myself, get more nutrition and not have a fine mesh on it. But we're gonna go ahead and try this, because I gotta wash down that fresh ginger, which lit me up. So to me, this is like drinking water compared to the ginger shots I make on a daily basis. I generally have about 3 ounces of my ginger shot, which is ginger, turmeric, and lemon. And this is like 4 ounces of mostly turmeric, so it's a lot more mild. This has definitely helped me wash my mouth out of that hot spice there. So I think they use like the standard like red kind turmeric in here. If they use like the more medicinal stuff, people will start complaining that it tastes too strong. Once again, this stuff's only available at the local farmer's market. Wow, that was good. That definitely cuts down that ginger flavor. All right. Now what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and try some of these mushroom extracts. Hey, it's the nighttime and I'm gonna be going to bed soon. And so they have a different kind of mushroom extracts, and they basically use a 2-stage dual extraction process. So everybody, alcohol extract is better, or water extract is better. Of course, both these, they heat the water up to do the extract for the hot water. And so what's better, man? Alcohol or water extract? You know, I say combine them both, and that's actually what they have in here. Dual extract, so we're just gonna go ahead and take a tincture, and they get organic cane alcohol, I believe, in here. So the ingredients are really clean. All it is basically organic alcohol, distilled water, and organic lion's mane mushroom, organic turmeric grown with love. All right. So let's see if this lights me up. Here's the, this is alcoholic, so don't drink the whole thing, you could get drunk. All right, underneath the tongue, let it sit there. Woo-hoo! This is burning the alcohol. You know what? Wow. That's crazy. That reminds me of eating chocolate. I'm not a big fan of chocolate, but this has like a nice chocolatey flavor to me. Personally, we're going to head and hit this again. And I'm not an alcohol drinker. Wow. That's good. I definitely have that flavor in my mouth. I like that. That's good. So if you're looking for some good high-quality extract that they literally grew the mushrooms, it's not coming from China, right? I think it's coming from China. You never know if it's real or not. They grew the mushrooms here, and they grew the turmeric here, and they processed it here, and it's great, right? The next product that they will ship to you, and I think the last product I'm going to try for you guys today, is their golden milk. So this is the unlabeled version. By the time you guys see this video, they're going to have the fully labeled version. This is like the turmeric they grew on site. It has some black pepper in there, and I think it also has the coconut milk that is organic and previously dried, and then they basically add that to the mixture to make their golden milk. Oh, and this one also has the sugar in there. I prefer the one without the sugar, but for most people, they're going to want the sugar because it's not going to taste good without. So we're going to go ahead and make some golden milk. I mean, I would prefer to do this fresh. I would make my own coconut milk, juice my own turmeric, add my own pepper in there, and make it fresh, but people aren't going to do that. So I like this as a convenient way to get some of the beneficial curcumin from the turmeric, as well as along with the pepper that can increase the uptake of some of the benefits of the curcumin along with that fat. So I mean, this is an all-in-one package. If you guys just want to be the end user consumer and take something that's easy and not have to juice it, deal with it, this is what you're going to want to do. So normally you would take basically 3 tablespoons of this powder and then mix it in water. I'm a guy and I don't measure anything, so we're just gonna take some of this. We're just gonna liberally dump this in. All right, think that's 3 tablespoons yet? I don't think so. We're gonna add some more. So we're gonna add this much. Don't want to add too much. Actually, that's probably too much, but I don't really care. So we'll see what happens. So we're gonna go ahead and put that in there, and now we've got this hot water. I don't like to drink things that's super hot myself, so hopefully this is cooled off a little bit. I like to have things about room temperature, maybe a little bit warmer, maybe like 100 degrees. So we're gonna pour this hot water in there. Hopefully that's not super hot. And it's pretty hot, it's steaming a little bit. It's not that hot. All right, so once you got that in there, then you wanna mix it up. So I would recommend like a frother like they gave me today. So we got a little frother here. We're gonna go ahead and put it in. And we press this and it just spins. All right, watch this. Oh wow, check that out, right? We're mixing that up. Very important to get all that coconut milk powder mixed up and get the turmeric and the black pepper evenly distributed. Check that out, man. We're adding some froth in there. This is gonna be super delicious, man. So if you guys drink Starbucks, man, I really don't want you guys to drink Starbucks. They have so much sugar and all this kind of stuff in there. This is the stuff you want to take. And if you guys are drinking coffee, hey, use this actually as your creamer. This will make your coffee even healthier, all right? So we got this nice and frothed up. Look at that. All right. All right. Let's go ahead and try this. All right, this is nice temperature for me, and this will hopefully cut the flavor of the ginger, the extracts, and all the stuff I've been eating crazy today. Oh my God, that is completely amazing. This is what I need on a cold West Palm Beach, Loxahatchee evening to basically eat or drink after all these hardcore things I'm eating. This is really nice and warming, man. I get to sit here and drink it with my winter hat on. Wow, kind of reminds me of like drinking like a soup, because it's got the coconut. This is completely delicious. If you're looking for like probably the best golden milk, aside from the coconuts, which they should locally source and make some, everything else is sourced, grown here, and it's organic. All the ingredients are organic in there. So yeah, completely amazing golden milk. I'm gonna carefully and take my time drinking this amazing beverage here, and when we come back, we're gonna go ahead and get the owner, the farmer here, the owner Joseph, who works too much. Get more sleep, Joseph, and we're gonna interview him and talk more about the gratitude garden here. Learn how he actually healed himself from the stage 4 colon cancer and learn why he basically goes and grows some of the best produce and foods on the entire planet that can help you heal. So now I'm here with Joseph of Gratitude Garden Organic Farm, USDA certified, and we're going to share with you guys actually more about his story, why he chooses to have an organic farm growing some of the most nutritional foods on the planet and also make them available for you guys. So Joseph, the first thing I want to clear up is it true that you actually had stage 4 cancer and then you healed yourself through many different methods? I'm not going to say it's this method or that method. You want to share that actually story, kind of condensed version, because I know I heard the whole thing, but share with people on what you did, because maybe somebody out there is working with that, and I know some of your family members, I don't know if I could say that on the camera, are even working with that now.
Mm-hmm. Yes. About 10 years ago, I got diagnosed with a stage 4 cancer. It was a colon liver cancer. I went through conventional treatment for about a year. It was rough, to say the least. But I stopped slightly early because I felt my body starting to slip away. It wasn't reacting to the chemo properly. I was my body was getting really poisoned and it was suffering. So I stopped early against the oncologist's wishes, but I stopped early and I went to a place in West Palm called Hippocrates Health Institute, which is a raw food center. I actually went there just to detox. I learned about raw foods, juicing, wheatgrass, oxygen. I learned about so many different things. And then that was the beginning of my journey. And then I just kind of spun off from there and I did so many different things. It's hard to tell what it was. I mean, it could be the operation, it could have been chemo, it could have been the raw foods, it could have been so many different things that I did. It's very hard. But what I do know is that I'm here still 10 years later. I'm still a vegan. I'm not as high raw as I once was, but I think that has a lot to do with it. I worked on all emotions also. That's huge, because if your body's in fight or flight, it cannot heal. So you need to release fight or flight, and that's usually caused by emotions. So if you can release those, your body could be able to take in all the nutrition that you're getting from the raw foods, the oxygen from the raw foods, the chlorophyll, all that stuff. So I believe it's a combination of everything that I did. But I know a lot of people, especially now, are going to be suffering with that. They know somebody, or they might be going through it, or they know family members that are going through it, and it's very, very tough. What I can say is every single cancer patient has their own journey to go through. Some are going to make it, some are not, and there's really not much you can do. You can't really push on your opinions and views on them. At the end of the day, it's their journey, and if they're meant to be here, they'll be here. But what I did was, I moved to a high nutrient, dense, oxygenated foods. I eliminated all the stressors in my life that caused my body to be in fight or flight. And then I focused on growing all my own food as much as I could. I turned one of my bedrooms into a sprout room. I turned my other bedroom into a full-on gym, which had an infrared sauna in there. And then I also started raised beds. And that's actually how I come across John about 10 years ago. I was watching his videos and he actually inspired me to grow my own food. And then I started growing raised beds in my front side of my house, back of my house, front of my house. And then it just got to a point where I had no more room and neighbors were coming by trying to barter with me for veggies. And I was like, oh. So my wife and I decided to purchase a piece of land here in West Palm Beach in Loxahatchee and start the journey of this organic farm. Farming is a very rewarding but very, very difficult feat. People have a very romanticized version of what farming really is. And it can be that, but if you're relying on it for your income, it can be, you have to find your balance. And I haven't found that yet. I'm working far too much. And my wife always gets on me on that, but it's like my passion. I love to do it, but I have to find that balance. So that's something that's very important also. But we're focusing here on this farm on creating the most medicinal foods and products that we can. So we grow a lot of turmeric, ginger, and mushrooms, and we believe that we can make very, really, really beneficial products out of those. So.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, we're not here to say like any one food or product will heal your whole body, but here's the thing. I also eat a very high nutrient dense diet. Actually, that's why I grow my own food, and I don't trade with my neighbors. I keep it all in-house. I juice it, eat it, preserve it so I can eat it later. And you know, that's what I try to eat as much food as I possibly can under my garden. And I would encourage you guys to do likewise, you know, grow some of the most nutritional foods. And unfortunately, where I live at present time, one day I'll hopefully live in the tropics. You know, I don't grow as much turmeric and ginger, so I'm really glad I found the resource here to, you know, to source some of the turmeric and ginger I will be eating hopefully in the future here, and juice, you know, to get some really medicinal, you know, food, more medicinal food into me. So, so why did you start the farm? You know, I know you use the farm as your personal, like, basically, like, grocery store. Literally, this is your grocery store, because you can go out and harvest anything. I mean, they will grow a lot more than what I could show you guys, because a lot of it's for personal consumption that they actually don't sell. It's not for sale at any price. I don't care how much money you guys have, even if you drive a Lamborghini or a Rolls Royce or all these crazy cars I see down here, because there's lots of rich people down here, actually. And they seem to be on their horn a lot, in my opinion. which alone is stressful to live here in West Palm Beach, in my opinion, coming from the West, where people are more relaxed, or where I've been to Hawaii, and it's just everything on island time. Hey, kudos to you guys that are out on island time, man. I love that lifestyle. But why did you choose to grow the food, you know, and do that as a business to share with people, when you could have just bought 5 acres and just grown all your own food for you and your family and had the highest quality food without, you know, starting a farm, hiring employees, putting down shipping containers and multiple ones, or buy, you know, local people with some of the best food. And let me tell you guys, I went to the farmer's market the other day here on Sunday, Palm Beach Lakes, I believe, right? Palm Beach Gardens, wherever it was. And there was like maybe I counted two, maybe three. I think one was a scam.
Right there.
Yeah, you know, you guys were one of the real farmers there. And there's like one other guy that's growing stuff. And like, yeah. And otherwise, I think, you know, it's like a lot of people selling non-food items. So, I mean, it is hard farming in this area for sure. And so why did you decide to start a farm and make this food available?
Well, mostly because I believe in it. It's something that we eat, and that's what we grow. And I know it's hard to find good quality food. So for us, it's something like, I was in, you know, in business and sales, but I was always forced to sell things that I didn't believe in. That's what sales is. You have to sell in order to get paid. And for me, I would rather make less money and sell something I believe in than sell something for someone else and that I didn't believe in. So that was the main reason, is changing my career and doing something I love. And in this journey that I've been going through with my wife, growing food was something that really grounded me, made me happy. I enjoyed it. But now it got, you know, we grew kind of a little too fast. So it became more like a business again. Well, what, it's been a business from day one, but I'm saying it became too much of a business where I wasn't able to get in the field as much as I wanted to. And now I have to hire other people to help me, and I much prefer to just be there myself doing a lot of the stuff. So winding down, maybe lowering the amount of markets I do, that I could actually enjoy what I do a lot more, because then it's not like, you know, I have 6 employees to pay and this, and my electric bill's $1,400 a month and blah, 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 and it's just nonstop. So if we wind everything down, maybe I can get to the point where that love and that passion just is at the highest level. I still love what I do, but I definitely have to wind down, because I don't sleep that much, and I work way too much, and I want to be able to spend more time with my family, especially now when they need me, to be able to go and spend time with them and help them. Like, you know, I have people that I need to be there for right now, and I can't, because I'm a slave to my farm, yeah. but I love it. So I'm not like a slave, but it's a weird relationship. It's hard to explain. It's really hard to explain. My wife could, you know, my wife isn't this. She loves it, but not like I do in a different way. I'm a little bit more intense when it comes to the farming, and what we do here. We're gonna find that balance, and we're getting there, and that's why we're moving more to medicinal products and making products from what we grow, and shipping them across the United States. And that's really where we want to be.
So. Cool, and yeah, that's why I got to share with you guys some of the products that they'll be having available now by the time you guys are watching this video. And you know, I want to talk about that real quick. You know, being in alignment with who you are, right, and selling a product that you believe in. That's not, you're just not selling widgets for dollars just because you could sell any old widget, right? Like, you know, for me, I went to school for marketing. I could be marketing anything. I'm sure many of my different, you know, graduates, fellow graduates that graduated in marketing are selling so many other things that are not helping people. You know, I sell juicers for a living. That's what I do for a living. That's how I make my income, you know, and I'm glad to sell juicers because juicers have helped me tremendously. It allows me to juice things like the turmeric and the ginger, you know, that I actually juiced today in one of the juicers, and get those into my body because I have seen tremendous health benefits from the different foods. You know, and I mean, what I do, I basically sell you guys on growing your own food and eating healthy food. And I love doing that because, once again, I'm in complete alignment because I really do this. I'm not like some kind of, you know, you're going to see me ever eating McDonald's. I mean, you might see me buying some sugar at the store because I'm putting in my kombucha to let my kombucha scoby eat it, or to rub it on my skin in an oil sugar scrub. I don't eat sugar. Well, I had some, a little bit of sugar tonight, but it's not my first choice. You know, I'd rather eat fresh fruits and vegetables for my nutrition, right? So yeah, very important to be in alignment. That's another thing I want you guys to really remember. And if you guys are not in alignment in whatever things in your life, I want you guys to reevaluate and check that. Maybe you guys need to change your life, you know, because once again, if you're not in alignment, that's something that's going on with you, and that might be one of the many causes of, you know, health conditions, in my opinion. And here's the thing, I'll tell you this on the camera, Joseph. So, I mean, you grow so many different things, and that's great, because I know you're going to grow so many different things for you and your family anyways, but at the same time, like, to grow all these things in a big commercial scale and always have something available at the farmer's market, not always the best, because I know you have items that basically make you more profit, ones that make you less profit, ones that are more labor-intensive, ones that are less labor-intensive, so I would encourage you, as a business owner myself, to focus on the products that make you, you know, that you have to put the least labor in, that grow really easy, that make you the most profit, and maybe put to the side, even though you're serving the community and they're able to get more food, you have to serve yourself first, because if you're not here, you can't serve anybody else anything. So, you know, go for the high margin. And the products are easier, because some products are way easier than others. Dial those in, of course, grow all the other things for you and your family, but not in the mass abundance that you do. So then you don't have to, like, you don't have to work as hard, man. You know, because we're here to you know, and I'm glad you're here doing your mission to bring some high quality food. And if I had more time, I'd kind of get more into the details, because he really kind of gets into some of the nitty gritty on growing high quality food that I didn't get to share with you guys because of the, you know, it got dark really fast and I got here late because I was filming earlier. And then I actually have to do my own work every day. So what I want to get into next, Joseph, is let's talk more about this special turmeric, you know, because I know you're like the expert on this stuff since you've been growing it. You know, why did you choose to grow turmeric? And this is a Hawaiian red turmeric, you know, and that's what you're known for. He has a website, organicturmeric.com, which is quite impressive to me, because it is certified organic turmeric, and he has more varieties than other places that I have visited in the past. So why don't you talk about that?
Like I said, we grow about 5-6 varieties. They all have different uses. The red is probably the best for juicing. It's milder. For most people, John is a little bit of a freak of nature when it comes to the turmeric. He just can eat a black turmeric and no problem.
Well, it was strong. The black was strong.
Yeah, this one is what we sell a lot of in our juices that we make, which is the little, I think you
guys know. Well, I drank them.
like I said, we've got the Thai variety right here, which is called BKK, which is a great medicinal variety. We make tinctures out of those also, and we combine them with medicinal mushrooms like reishi, turkey tail, which we grow also. We also grow lion's mane, which I believe is a nice block right behind me.
Yeah, I showed it earlier.
We grow those and we extract those because they have all the the brain nerve medicinal properties in them. So we extract them with alcohol, and we do something called a dual extraction, where we soak them with the reishi, we soak in organic alcohol for 6 to 8 weeks. We extract all the terpenes, we extract a lot of the medicinal properties from the alcohol, and then we'll do a boil, a little soak, like a simmer for a couple of an hour or so from the mushroom, and then we'll combine it back with the alcohol soak for a dual extraction. So what the alcohol extracts, the water can't, and what the water extracts, the alcohol can't. So it's a dual extraction. Very hard to find those,
Made in the U.S. The products he grew. He's not like importing different mushrooms and then making it and selling it. He knows a whole entire process.
Yes, we grow it from A to Z right now. We make all our own blocks. We used to purchase blocks, but we now make our own. We have our own lab. We make our own, which is extra work, which is great. It's
So, but you're doing it right. Now you know, the whole process, and you can control the entire process.
Yes, and then we're very, very happy about this one, because this one is actually almost extinct in India.
Wow.
Because, and the reason being is because...
if people don't like it, it doesn't taste too strong.
This was planted at the same time as this.
Wow.
So this is one plant, this is one plant.
Wow.
If you're a farmer, what are you growing? You're growing this one.
So, well, it depends. How much more does this produce? 5 times more, and then what? Yeah. Can you sell that for 5 times more money? But,
I mean, realistically, no one's gonna be paying $60.
Especially when it doesn't taste that good.
It doesn't taste good, so it's extinct. But in India, there, it's actually very sought after. But most people are not growing because it yields very poorly. But it's the most medicinal turmeric on the planet. It's one of the top. I believe the blue. They call it black turmeric, but it's kind of like a indigo blue in a way. It's a beautiful turmeric, but it's very, very strong. So we're going to extract those and make them into tinctures, because I don't think that, or encapsulate them. So we're planning on encapsulating them also, because the tincture will probably be nasty also. But I would much prefer to take a tincture.
That's a judgment.
Than a shot. Okay, so I said I was going to, I don't know what I would do.
Are you going to eat it, man? Let's eat each of it. So I want you guys to watch our faces, because we're going to both do this, and we're going to have different reactions. I don't know. But he grows his stuff. This is maybe the third time now, because I tried to live it earlier and came in the second time. Wait, give me the same size piece.
You're gonna make my hand better than me.
Wait, what size piece did you get?
I'm just gonna like that piece. Yeah,
so not that much. Is that the same amount? All right, we're gonna do this. Watch our faces, man.
It takes a couple seconds to kick in.
No, I'm tasting it. It's hard to describe. Like, it tastes nothing
else. It tastes like cough syrup. Straight up nasty cough syrup.
Well, do you think, I mean, that's if you think cough syrup tastes nasty.
It's very bitter.
It's really strong. Like, I'm feeling it all in my mouth. And here's the thing, like, if you go into thinking it's going to be nasty, you're gonna have a face like that. If you think, oh, yeah, this is good and medicinal, this is healing me.
That's true.
I mean, I'm tasting it. It's like, I feel the sensations, and it's strong. I'm not going to say it's not. It tastes like cough syrup. Yeah, I'm not going to say it doesn't. And maybe I'm also in a place where I'm just like, all right, I'm going to be chill about this, and he's going to be all crazy.
No, I can handle it. It is
strong, and I'm feeling the little tickle in my throat. Mm-hmm.
The white turmeric does that too.
Yeah.
The white turmeric is a very floral turmeric. I don't know if when you ate it.
I like the flavor.
Yeah, it's mild, but
I didn't like the throat thing. Mm-hmm. That's why I like the Hawaiian one better, because that to me like is eating like carrots. Yeah. The Hawaiian turmeric is like eating carrots.
Well, actually, my wife Tana, she does a couple good turmeric videos on our Instagram.
Oh, cool.
On how to make turmeric paste and how to make turmeric tea and how to do different shots, where we actually make a big batch and then we'll put them in ice cube trays and freeze them for the average person. So, you know, if someone can't realistically juice every day, they can pour a big chunk fresh into the ice cube trays and freeze them, and then have a little blocks, and they can put them in their water and their juices down the road. So that actually works really good for a lot of people, because a lot of people don't want to dirty their juicer for a shot of turmeric.
So what I would recommend instead of doing the ice, because making the ice, you're locking in the nutrition, but the problem is once you thaw it, then it's exposed to the air and starts to oxidize, and you probably lose nutrition. check it out. I'm fine with that. And so what I do is actually I'll make a big jug, like a 24-ounce bottle of ginger. I use mostly ginger. If I hopefully get more turmeric, I'll use more turmeric. But it's mostly ginger, turmeric, and lemon. I'll make it 24 ounces. Then I'll basically vacuum seal it. So I make it like once a week. And then basically I pour off 3 ounces a day and maybe a little bit more. So then that 24 ounces basically lasts me for about 5 to 7 days. And every time I open it, it's under vacuum. Then I vacuum seal it again, put it back in my fridge, keep the fridge cold, I keep it at 35 degrees, 34, 35 degrees optimally. Keep it nice and cold under vacuum with the lemon for antioxidant and under vacuum. And I have no problem storing it for a week and it still stays fresh and good. And that to me is now I'm juicing turmeric and ginger shot, you know, my shot once a week.
That's a good idea. For me, when I get a 3 or 4 month period where I'm dry, so I don't have any turmeric. Mm. So that's when I'll freeze it.
Sure.
Because I don't want to buy someone else's turmeric.
So, I just buy somebody else's turmeric. I'm not that connoisseur.
Yeah, I can't. So that's what we do in the off season.
Sure.
But it's only like 3 months where, you know, around April, May, because we're planting in April, May. So, you know, and then we start harvesting again around September, October.
Oh, September, October.
Yeah, yeah, September, sure. October. That's so, early.
Tell me about like...
Yeah. That's the Thai turmeric.
Yeah, tell about this one, because this is the more medicinal standard turmeric, not the black turmeric that's a super ultra medicinal, but this is the more...
This one is very palatable. It actually has a nice flavor. Thai cuisine, they actually put them in curries too. And it's a legit turmeric. It has about 8-12% curcumin rating. The seed company that I purchased this from is in Hawaii. And then we basically replicate our seed and replant them now. But initially we bought them in Hawaii, and they're an organic farm over there. And it's the highest testing turmeric that they have, that they sell, other than the black. But the black, like I said, is very rare. It's almost extinct.
And very strong to eat.
Right. And what we're doing is we're bringing it back alive because we're growing it. For 3 years, I haven't sold a stick of it.
Wow.
I've just been replicating it.
Wow.
Because it's super expensive.
So just use it in-house.
Yeah, I couldn't buy it.
So am I like the first human being to sample it aside from you guys?
Sampled to one or two other people. I haven't sold a single stick of it.
Wow.
Super
rare.
I'm keeping it. Yeah. I'm making medicinal tinctures out of it. We also grow red galangal, and we also grow a yellow. And
those are both galangals, yeah.
Yeah, they're both galangals, which is basically a medicinal Thai ginger. Actually, they have incredible anti-cancer properties.
Oh man, I gotta include more of that in my diet.
It's really, really incredible. We did a lot of research on it, and we found out it has a huge amount of anti-cancer properties.
And this is more easy to grow in almost tropical areas. So like zone 9A, 9B, these would do a lot better than the standard gingers for sure. And actually, he'll sell them to you just like that. So you can actually plant these guys because they're actually growing now.
Yeah, absolutely. And then, what else do we have? We have the white and the yellow. The yellow is what you'll find in a powdered form in your store. That yellow turmeric powder is usually made from the Indian yellow or the Indira yellow, which is a yellow variety, and that's what's in your curries. If you go to Indian restaurants, they usually use this variety, which is, it's a very high yielding turmeric. So if you're trying to, if you have a shorter turmeric season, you know, the yellow one it grows in about 6 months, other than 5 to 6
months.
So
a lot of you guys, for a summer season, you can maybe get away with it if your season is long enough.
You can, yeah, you absolutely can grow that in a lot of areas. You can grow that. Out of all the turmerics, I would definitely pick the yellow and the white. The white's very hardy, and you can grow that in about 5 to 6 months.
Really?
Also,
awesome.
And you get huge clusters from the white and the yellow. The Hawaiian red and the Thai, they're a little bit more finicky, and they're not as forgiving. So for beginners, I would definitely recommend the yellow and the white, just because it's easy.
Cool. I never learned this before.
Yeah, that's easy. And we also grow a Hawaiian yellow baby ginger, but it's no longer baby now because it's now almost.
It was
February.
Pretty strong. I had it, and it affected me.
Yeah, it's.
I mean, that was stronger than actually the black turmeric. Actually,
ginger's no joke.
That was no joke.
Yeah,
when I ate it, I had to take a break. Actually, I had to stop filming.
It's awesome. Yeah. Okay, I didn't get to witness that. Damn, I wish I
saw. Well, the old boy will see it on the camera.
Oh, good. And then this is the medicinal mushroom tinctures that we make, and we combine it with the Thai turmeric, the 8-12% curcumin rating, because we know that turmeric. Most people think turmeric is just for inflammation and pain, and it's actually not. It has so many benefits. It works great on your brain too. Cognitive function, it helps with depression, mood, all those things. So we stacked it with the lion's mane dual extraction because and a lot of our customers are having great results with this.
So how has this product helped you?
Yeah, well, the lion's mane works really well alone. I eat a lot of lion's mane, but this combination with the turmeric, I feel it almost instantly. So I feel sharpness, I feel alert, concentration, and I get an immediate elevation of mood, where I feel like just feel a little bit better, like in general, mood wise. So we've done our research on combining these two. I don't think there's many people that actually combine these two in a tincture form. And we actually combine it in the powdered form in the golden milk that we're going to be selling also.
So there's lion's mane in there too.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't mention that.
Yes,
I didn't know.
This is lion's mane.
Oh no, this I just been eating lion's mane. Cool. Yeah.
So this is dehydrated lion's mane with BKK Thai turmeric powder.
So that's the most medicinal.
Yep. The most medicinal turmeric mixed with the lion's mane. And then the Ayurvedic spices, the Ayurvedic herbs that make a golden milk.
Oh, I forgot. I didn't mention that either.
Well,
I didn't know the lion's mane yet. Yeah.
So that's what we're doing, and then we're making it instant so that you don't have to add like almond milk or coconut. It's already got the organic coconut milk powder in it. So you just put like 3 tablespoons of it, and it makes a perfect, so you can take it with you, you can travel with it. You don't have to have an almond milk or coconut milk with you, or any kind of, you know, nut milks. You can have it on the go, and that's why we made it, because
yeah, it was so good. I ate like half the package.
You did. That's a huge package. I can't
believe
you did that.
I'm hardcore, dude. Maybe. Oh yeah, I'm gonna do this one. I didn't do this one yet. I'm gonna dump this in my mouth while you keep talking about it.
What? Are you really?
Yeah, I am. So, yeah, keep talking about it. Now. Tell me.
So, yeah. So we. So John is now pouring the golden milk powder directly into his mouth. But
I'm hardcore, man. You don't believe me.
He's super hardcore.
This stuff is good plain! It's better plain than with the hot water.
So, a lot of people are going to use it as a coffee creamer. There's a lot of buzz right now with Lion's Mane, and you'll see like Four Sigmatic. Like, you'll see a bunch of products right now that make a bunch of coffee products that, you know, I don't know.
But ask them if they grew it.
They don't grow it, that's for sure. They definitely don't grow it. And you have to be careful with mushroom products, and when you guys buy, let's say, reishi powder and all that stuff, if you actually really look at the ingredients, it's actually brown rice with the mycelium of the reishi on it, or the mycelium, because you can't really powder reishi and eat it, because the chitin would totally jack up your stomach. So you cannot really digest it. It's very woody, it's hard. So they usually add the mycelium of the reishi to a sterilized grain, either probably usually brown rice, and it colonizes the brown rice, and they powder that, and they sell you that as the reishi powder. Now, there is a lot of information that, you know, studies that show that there is a lot of benefit in the mycelium, but we prefer to use the fruiting body itself. That's what we prefer, and there's a lot of other mushroom growers that will attest to that. But, you know, there's also a lot that say the mycelium's fine too. So, you know, there's a few different
pros and cons, and I would include both personally.
Yeah, well, there is mycelium in the mushroom too.
Of course.
In the fruiting body, there's plenty of mycelium too. So it's just a matter of, it's easier to do a powder than
with a lot of filler.
Yeah,
than a real 100%. Yeah.
There are some other ways to do it, but it's very, very complicated. But most people just put it in the rice, and then they just powder the rice, and then that has plenty of mycelium in it, so they just sell it to you as a powder like that. But this is the real, for me, the dual extraction is the real deal, because it's and I spoke to contract manufacturers to see if they would make it for me, and none of them would.
So you have to make it yourself, literally, to make it happen.
Yeah, so we have our own commercial kitchen. We're working on a GMP lab so that we can do large amounts of them. But nobody would do it for us, because the last thing I need now is more work.
But you're bringing out the highest quality products that, I mean, I've never seen anybody make their own and even grow their own. Like, that's impressive, man. I mean, bow down to you, man. You know, I mean, this is cool what this guy is doing. So you missed my whole question. My question was, why did you choose to grow turmeric of all the different crops you could grow in the entire world? And focus, I mean, I know you grow a lot of crops, but why did you focus on turmeric and have organicturmeric.com?
Because turmeric is one of the most medicinal plants or roots on the planet, and we're all about making the most medicinal products and food that we can grow for ourselves and for other people. Mm. So we want to help people as well as ourselves, because we're doing it for ourselves mostly, and then we're doing it for other people also. But, you know, and we're picking the varieties that we feel are the best for specific things. Like, when people ask me, well, which one should I get, I tell them, you know, are you just maintaining? Are you working with an issue, an illness or something? If someone has cancer or anything like that, I automatically tell them to go with the Thai turmeric, the BKK. If there's just someone that just wants to be healthy, I tell them to go with the red, because you don't need the Thai. The Thai is just too strong for that. You know?
You can eat twice as amount of red. And actually, the red on some levels is better because it's more red.
But ironically enough, everyone still goes with the Thai, regardless. So I don't even bring the other varieties to the market, because everyone just wants the Thai turmeric.
I want them all, because each one has a little bit different properties.
Yeah, and I like to use them for different things. I mean, the red is, in our elixirs that we make, it's mostly red. We tried doing it with the BKK, but it didn't really work out well, because we were doing 2-ounce shots right there with the Omega at the market, and people were shooting them, and they literally had to sit down because they would turn white. So, like, they would get super nauseous, because turmeric on an empty stomach can kind of, you know, but it can be a little bit rough.
Especially if you're not used to it.
Especially if you're toxic, too, because it pulls on you. It pulls You know, so the more toxic you are, the more nauseous you feel when you take it, especially
Oh, I know. My ex-girlfriend felt nauseous when I gave her my turmeric ginger drink, so that's why. She's toxic. She doesn't watch my videos, thank God. I'll say it.
That's funny.
She's been eating really crappy lately after we broke up, too, but that's another topic.
It's too funny.
All right, yeah, so anyways, nonetheless, this is some medicinal stuff, guys, so let's see. So I want to share with my viewers, so like, I know some of my viewers are gardeners, and they want to grow this stuff. They want to have the best stuff. I mean, yeah, I trust you to grow mine, because I can't really grow it in my climate, but if someone wants to grow it and buy it, and, you know, say they order this stuff from you, and you ship a bunch, right?
Yeah.
How do they make this sprout and grow it, and then, I mean, what are some general tips on growing the turmeric, since, sure. I mean, you've been growing it for years,
yeah.
And you're an expert.
Okay, so basically with turmeric, they have nodes. The difference between turmeric and ginger grows up, turmeric grows down. So with ginger, you need to mound your ginger. So you don't just plant ginger and leave it.
Oh, wow, I've been screwing that up.
Yeah, because you won't get proper root formation, rhizome formation. It will just stay at the soil level. And once you see it poking out of the soil, you want to mound it up with extra compost and then feed it. So every time you mound it, you want to feed it with some organic fertilizer. So that's with ginger. So
that's a lot of work. I might just grow turmeric.
Yeah, turmeric's a little easier. But turmeric, for instance, if you look at this big cluster here, you don't need a lot of turmeric. So this right here would be a perfect seed to plant. So I don't plant it a certain way. I plant it straight flat like this, because you've got nodes right here, 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 here. They'll all shoot up green. Like, that's how it will start off. So the first 2 to 3 months, it will be mostly green. There won't be any rhizome formation, really. And you need to feed it every 2 to 3 months.
So what do you feed it?
Well, we feed it organic composted chicken manure, we feed it worm castings, we feed it compost teas, and things like that. And then we add, like I told you before, we add some volcanic rock dust in the soil to get extra minerals in there, which I believe in also. So that's what we feed it, and you have to do that, I'd say, at least 3 times in the growing season. Turmeric can take anywhere from 6 to 9 months to grow to full formation. Now, we start harvesting it early as a baby, but, you know, it's better to let it grow. You know, in Florida, we usually plant in March, April, and then harvest in, like, right now, January, February, you know.
So it actually grows through the hot summers here?
Yes, it grows really well in the hot summers. You just have to be careful with the with our fields. We've had some problems with the rain, so you have to build like a little ditch around your field, so if it does rain, your turmeric doesn't sit in water.
Oh, that's why you're growing in bags now a lot.
Yeah, we grow it in bags, we grow it in raised beds, and we grow it in the fields. Mm. But we raise everything up, so even the fields we raise up.
Of those three methods, what's the best way to do it for people that don't want to experiment with all the three different kinds?
I would say raised beds.
Oh, well,
just a standard raised bed, but be ready to give up that space for 6 to 8 months, because you're not going to be able to grow anything in there if you take that up. So that's something you have to take into consideration. And for us, it's even more challenging, because I have to crop rotate, because I'm certified organic. So I cannot grow turmeric in the same spot for 3 years. So now I constantly am making new fields on the farm. I'm like, oh, I'm running out of space. So I constantly
and more work. Right
there. And more. Just add it to my list. So we're constantly doing that. And then the bags are a good way, because then I can add, I can grow in the same spot in certain areas. So on the pad, I just put new soil in every year, organic soil, and then I can grow in the bags. I do that with the ginger too. The ginger I grow in bags, just because it doesn't like wet feet. And neither does turmeric. If you get, like, we had a couple of heavy rains where, like, 2 years ago, we had a whole, like, 2 acres planted of turmeric, and it rained all of May, every day, all day long. And it flooded out my fields, and we were like racing across against the clock to try and dig a ditch around the field to drain out all the field that the turmeric was sitting in water for like days.
Was it rot? Like,
we lost about at least a third of our field, almost half of our field to rot.
More work.
Yeah,
damn rain.
So you know, you have to take that into consideration. I mean, no one's, you know, I don't know if anyone's growing in mass amounts, but in raised beds, you're safe. It's raised along, you know, if you're growing in South Florida, it will grow really well here. You can grow it in different parts of the United States also. You just got to make sure that it doesn't like cold. So
what's the coldest temperature to deal with?
It starts to, the leaves will, you'll start to see your leaves start to turn brown, and that will be an indication that it's too cold for you.
And what's that? So, when does that happen here?
Say like in this mid-70s.
Wow, it doesn't like the mid-70s, low 70s.
No, it likes high 80s, man. It likes hot, humid weather.
So you can have 6 months of hot, humid weather. Yeah, I mean, it hasn't traditionally grown well for me in the arid climate, which is not humid.
But you have the heat there.
But I have the heat. Oh, yeah, I got heat. Yeah. So I'm going to try it in bags this year. I'm going to try it in pots or bags and then feed it more.
Yes.
No. I'm going to grow the turmeric in bags. Okay. It's easy because it's also well draining.
Yeah.
And I don't want to overwater either.
And you can move it too. If you get a cold snap, you can bring it inside.
Well, I'm not going to get a cold snap in the season it needs six, because I'm going to grow the easy 6 months. So once again, share those two easy 6 months, like the ones to grow.
The easiest ones to grow, I would say, would be the Indian yellow, which is the yellow one. It's a very, very hardy turmeric. It can handle a lot of abuse. It only needs around 6 months, and you get nice rhizome function out of them, and they get nice big chunks. And also the white turmeric is very hardy also, and it grows huge clumps, like 3-4 pound clumps on one
seed. How big are those clumps?
About 3 pound clumps.
Bigger. I like the flavor of this one actually more.
Yeah, per seed. So it doesn't, if you get a bigger seed, it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get a bigger cluster. You don't want a tiny seed and you don't need a huge seed, somewhere in between. So like something like this will grow perfectly. I wouldn't go much smaller than this, but something like that will grow.
That'll yield 3 pounds if grown properly in your feed. That's the other thing I don't do, is I should feed enough, because I'm like, oh, my soil's good, I need to feed.
No, you gotta feed it.
But you gotta feed it.
You gotta feed it.
For production.
You gotta feed it.
That's my problem. That's what I have not been doing.
Yeah, you gotta feed it.
So I'm glad we talked about this, and now you guys could do any other tips that you want to share with budding turmeric farmers, like literally budding.
Well, turmeric is not a very difficult crop to grow, so long as you have the right climate. If you're trying to grow it in upstate New York, you're probably not going to have great luck. If you're trying to grow it in Canada, you're probably not going to have luck. You're going to get, you'll get some rhizome function, but you're going to have like 3-4-5 months, probably like 4 months worth where it needs to be, and then right towards the end is when it starts to produce the rhizome. So right when it's starting to cool off is when it needs that extra heat. That's why, you know, Florida and Hawaii are two of the places that grows really well in the United States. I think in California, maybe Southern California, could probably grow okay. I don't really know too many turmeric farmers down there, but so my tip would just be grow it in a climate. If you can grow it in a greenhouse and extend it out another month and a half, so you'll get extra seasons in that. So if you are in a colder climate, plant it in March, you know, right.
But could you start it indoors first to get it to bud out first, and then have little baby transplants that you're growing already a month, so that takes off a month, and then now you only have 5 months in the field
in the raised bed? You absolutely can do that. We don't need to do it here.
Yeah, of course.
Just put it straight in the
ground. You don't need to do that because it's also more time and more labor, and you don't need to work more, Joseph.
Right. So, thank you. So basically what people do is they'll do like a tray of like sprouts.
Right.
And they'll, just like you're growing a tray of sprouts, and then they'll water that, and they'll just put the turmeric on that, and then they'll just keep it wet, moist, and then it will germinate.
Yeah, maybe use like a heat mat.
Yeah, you can use a heat mat and germinate in the greenhouse, and then once it pops, then you obviously want to think about planting it or putting it in a pot for a short time, but it can get root bound pretty quickly, so you don't necessarily want to keep it in a pot too long. You want to get it in the ground sooner than later. Because it doesn't like to be like really moved around too much.
So maybe like maximum time, like a month, you could save a month by maybe starting it in a little flat with the heat and then moving it up a little bit and then planting it right out.
Right.
But don't leave it in the pot.
And if you put it in a greenhouse, then you can get an extra month at the end, which is the most crucial point. It's when you get the bigger rhizomes, the longer you leave it in. And like I said, we don't harvest everything at once. We leave it in the ground. Even if there's no leaves, it looks like there's nothing there. It's like my farm looks a little messy because it has all the dead leaves, because I just leave them. But the real root is under the ground. So I just harvest it as I need it, always. So, you know, usually we have root all year round, but, you know, we sell a lot of turmeric. So we move it quite a lot. And I'm running out of space. Like, that's another problem.
So what are the months that those two that you could grow easily, the white and
the
then
white
the
and the yellow. Can... The yellow. Oh. It's right here.
Oh yeah, that one.
Yeah. The yellow.
The Indian, yeah.
Yeah, the Indian.
When are
yellow.
These available? So for people that, and so they could get started if they want to get started and grow this out. Because you gotta have the right timing, very important.
Yeah, we'll I think when this thing airs, it will probably be...
Just tell the months, because I don't...
Yeah, I would say you want to plant March, April.
But when you sell this, actually?
We'll should have some of this as seed, because we don't use it as much.
Uh-huh.
We use more the red and the Thai. The red we use our juices. So we'll probably be out of that by that time, to be honest.
So what are the months that this is available? So...
It's available all year round.
Oh, you sell this year round?
So long as it's still on the ground, yes. So as long as it's not sold out.
Yeah.
If I run out, then it's gone. But I'll leave it in the ground, because turmeric is also a perennial. So it will come back. The root that I was going to harvest to use will then become the seed.
Because you should divide them so you could get more.
Correct. And you want to use it. So turmeric should be grown as an annual, in my opinion. Some people grow it as a perennial, and they just leave it in the ground, just keep it going up, but then the other seed will then rot. So, do you get what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
So
you need to harvest your seed, guys.
Yeah, you need to harvest it. So, like I said, we'll be replanting again in March and April here on our farm, but we'll probably still have some that we use, throughout the year.
And that'll be, if it is available, it'll be on your website, which is?
OrganicTumeric.com. That will be on our website, along with our tinctures and our golden milk and any of our products that we grow on our farm. Will probably be on organicturmeric.com, even if it's not necessarily a turmeric product, but we will definitely be using a lot of medicinal.
And the products you're selling on your website are basically the products that, for the most part, you're making here.
Correct. Yes. The golden milk, we obviously don't grow coconut powder, so we buy that organic.
Maybe that's
one of the things that we.
You can have coconut palms lining your edges.
Actually,
along with the bananas.
I actually want to do that, but it's a hard sell on my wife.
And it takes a long time to grow those out.
Yeah.
Wife, let him plant the coconuts. All right. So, what are the final words of wisdom you'd like to share with my gardening community today? It could be about, the healing process you went through. Could be about growing. Could be about anything in life. That's an important message you want everybody to hear about coming from you.
Like I said, John's inspired me about 10 years ago when I started watching his videos. And growing my own food, there was nothing that really came close to that feeling of growing and harvesting your own food, going out to your backyard, cutting your food and eating it. And that did something to me, it sparked me, and that's one of the main reasons why I have my farm now. So my biggest thing would be to try and grow as much as you can, And John has so many videos to help you around that process. So. Growing your own food is super important, and grow what grows well in your environment, because otherwise you're going to have more success, less failures, and you're more likely to continue doing it. If you try to grow something I have a hard time growing lettuce in Florida because it's too hot and it's bitter, so I just don't do it. A lot of farms do it, but I don't want to sell bitter lettuce, because when I go to the market and I sell stuff, it's people love our stuff because I grow what I know is going to be great. So My tip would be just to grow what grows well in your environment and grow your food, whether that be microgreens, sprouts, whatever grows well in your environment.
So. Yeah, likewise. I mean, wise words from a farmer. I mean, that's what I teach. Grow what grows well for you. I mean, my summer garden always looks pretty amazing because while I do experiment with a few crops, new crops that I haven't grown before, the majority of what I grow is what I know is going to grow well. So my garden looks good. More importantly, so that I can eat out of my garden in the summertime when it's 100 plus degree in Las Vegas. So anyways, and finally thing I'm going to ask you, Joseph, is how can somebody contact you once again, your websites, your links, Instagram, any kind of social media that you would like to share? Once again, I'll post links down below to all the ones he's mentioning.
Instagram is Gratitude Garden Farm. It's at Gratitude Garden Farm on Instagram. And then just organicturmeric.com. And then Gratitude Garden Farm at yahoo.com. And you can just contact us through that. I respond. We have a Facebook page too, but my wife handles that. She's not really on top of the texting on that because she's super busy. Also,
so do the
Instagram.
DM
if you
want to
reach us, DM on Instagram. I'll always answer that.
Okay, good. So now I know that for the future, because I did message it through Facebook and I don't know if I got a response.
There you go.
And through the website. I actually contacted you on the website. Didn't get a response. So
really?
Yeah, I don't know. Anyways. But I did try to DM you on Instagram, and it said you're not allowed to send your message.
Because we weren't following each other. But once we're following,
I see. I don't know. Something happened weird, and I was like, oh man, I can't contact. I want to visit this guy because he's doing cool stuff. And yeah, what do you guys think? Was this a cool episode? Should I come back? And should Joseph be my new buddy? And I'm not going to try to be growing any turmeric in large quantities because once again, it's not easy for me. I'm gonna let him do it, and I'm gonna just have him show me some. What farmers markets are you currently selling at?
Well, I don't know if we're gonna be reducing down next season or not. We probably will be, but currently we're at West Palm Market, which is downtown Clematis Street. We're at Palm Beach Gardens. We're at Delray Beach Farmers Market, and we're also at Parkland Farmers Market. So we do four farmers markets a weekend, which is
a lot.
We used to do six, which was insanity.
He works too much. You can tell him too in the comments below. All right, so anyways, I gotta run. I gotta eat my first meal of the day because I pretty much only had juice so far. But if you guys enjoyed this episode with Joseph, want me to come back in future years when I'm in town to make more videos because he's doing a lot more that I couldn't share in this short video today because most of it's an interview. Please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also be sure to share this video with somebody else that lives in Palm Beach County area, right, that could support him locally because there's a lot more products that he could offer to you guys locally, and share this with people that are looking for high quality medicinal different varieties of turmeric as well as those mushroom extracts, which I'm kind of getting off on. And also be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you never know where I'm going to show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel, so get notified as my new videos come out every 5 to 7 days or 3 to 4 days, however fast I could get them up, because it's basically just me shooting, editing, and doing all the work for my videos right now. I lost my editor. And make sure to click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. Finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes going back 10 years that he was watching way back in the day. You know, I share over 1,500 episodes, actually 1,600 now probably, on how to grow your own food at home, you know, and grow the highest quality food. Because once again, I got into this because I almost lost my life. And, you know, I want you guys to be able to have the highest quality food if you want to. And I want you guys to have that gardening bug, right? It's so fun, so rewarding to grow your own food, to go back in your backyard. And I harvest my dinner every night out of my garden when I'm not traveling. And it's just so rewarding, and the food tastes better, so nutritious and amazing. All right? So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.